Lovely song to start with this morning, just to get us thinking away from rugby, away from football and all the other stuff, just thinking about the Lord, thinking about what he's done for us and what he's got for us. Song that when we played it the other week, lots of you said, oh, I love that song. It's a little song, There Is a Higher Throne.
Faithful ones from every tongue
Good morning, everybody. Lovely song based on the beginning of Revelation as John looks up to the heaven and he's given this brilliant revelation of God on his throne. It comes from Revelation chapter 4. This is what it says in the Bible. At once I was in the spirit, and there before me was a throne with someone sitting on it. And he goes on and he describes the scene, and he talks about the sea, which looks like emeralds and different colored stones resembling beauty. He talks about people and angels around the throne who are singing God's praises. And then he tells us what they were singing. He says, day and night, they never stop singing. Holy, holy, holy is the Lord God Almighty, who was and is to come. God, who's always the same, yesterday, today, and forever. He's our God, the one we've come to worship. And then looking at Jesus, the Lamb on the throne, said, you are worthy, our Lord and our God, to receive glory and honor and power, for you created all things, and by your will they were created and have their being. God is the start. He's the keeper. He's the originator, the sustainer of all things. He's our God. He's a great God, and we've come to worship him this morning. We worship you, our Father and our God, this morning. We worship you in words and songs. We worship you in our attention, our thoughts. We worship you with our spirit, desiring that you would speak to us through your word. We want to give to you the best. You are worthy. Yours is the name that is above every name. You were, you are, and you always will be the ever constant, unchanging God. And in a world of so much change, a world of so much uncertainty, we're thankful that we come to a God who's always the same. God always keeps his word, a God who's never taken by surprise, a God who's always in control, even though sometimes we struggle to see it. A God who over centuries has proven always to be right. And so we bow before your greatness today, your supremacy, your wisdom, your fairness and justice. We bow before you and we worship you, our God. Thank you for your grace to us. Thank you that you've called us to be your children. Thank you that you've called us into your kingdom. You are our Lord. You're our leader. You're our master. What a wonderful privilege is ours. As we start then, Lord, as we come to you as a people this morning, we have to say that we're sorry that we haven't always lived up to what you've called us to be. We've let you down in word and thought and deed. We've left undone things which we should have done and done things which we shouldn't have done. But we thank you for Jesus, who always lives to make intercession for us, who is at your right hand and cleanses us from all unrighteousness whenever we confess it. So we do that today as we come to you with the desire that you'll not see you'll not see any sin, but you will see us in Jesus, through whom alone that we can come to you. And then, Lord, as we come, some of us here today have had a tough week. It's a tough time. And so, our Father, for those people, I want to pray this morning that this time, whether they're with us live or whether they're watching later on YouTube or on the video, the DVD, that you will be speaking to them and lift their hearts and their spirits, fill them with joy once again. Hear our prayers then as we come to you this morning in Jesus' wonderful name. Amen. I want to give us the opportunity together to affirm what we believe and our faith in Jesus and our commitment to the Christian faith by sharing together, saying together what is known as the Apostles' Creed. It's the summary of the major Christian teaching, the major Christian truth, that which makes up the Christian faith. Obviously, to be a Christian, you've got to be a committed follower, believer and follower of Jesus. But what we're going to do here is just to share together the things at which we believe as followers of Jesus. And it can be a little bit kind of, what should we say? We can be a bit self-conscious when we're at home, sort of doing this by ourselves. I want to encourage not to be self-conscious, but to join in and to speak it out loud. If you've got somebody in the house with you, then, you know, say, yeah, we believe this. We believe this together, and let's not be ashamed of it. So join with me, and let's say together the Apostles' Creed. Three slides for this, just so that you know where we're going. Here we are. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day, he rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Let us pray together. Amen. Okay, let's come to God's word then. And I'm going to hand over to Kevin this morning, who's going to read for us from Ephesians, I think. Was it Ephesians or was it Corinthians? It was Corinthians, wasn't it, Kevin? Let me give you a shot. Corinthians chapter 12, if you want to be turning to that. Over to you, Kevin.
Okay, yeah. So 1 Corinthians chapter 12 and verses 12 to 30. And I've got this passage as entitled Unity and Diversity in the Body. So again, 1 Corinthians chapter 12, verses 12 to 30. Okay. So just as a body, though one, has many parts, but all its many parts form one body, so it is with Christ. For we were all baptized by one Spirit so as to form one body, whether Jews or Gentiles, slave or free, and we were all given the one Spirit to drink. Even so, the body is not made up of one part, but of many. Now, if the foot should say, because I am not a hand, I do not belong to the body, it would not for that reason stop being part of the body. And if the ear should say, because I am not an eye, I do not belong to the body, it would not for that reason stop being part of the body. If the whole body were an eye, where would the sense of hearing be? If the whole body were an ear, where would the sense of smell be? But in fact, God has placed the parts in the body, every one of them, just as he wanted them to be. If they were all one part, where would the body be? As it is, there are many parts, but one body. The eye cannot say to the hand, I don't need you. And the head cannot say to the feet, I don't need you. On the contrary, those parts of the body that seem to be weaker are indispensable, and the parts that we think are less honourable we treat with special honour. And the parts that are unpresentable are treated with special modesty, while our presentable parts need no special treatment. But God has put the body together, giving greater honour to the parts that lacked it, so that there should be no division in the body, but that its parts should have equal concern for each other. If one part suffers, every part suffers with it. If one part is honoured, every part rejoices with it. Now you are the body of Christ, and each one of you is part of it. And God has placed in the church, first of all, apostles, second, prophets, third, teachers, then miracles, then gifts of healing, of helping, of guidance, and of different kinds of tongues. Are all apostles? Are all prophets? Are all teachers? Do all work miracles? Do all have gifts of healing? Do all speak in tongues? Do all interpret? May God bless his word to us.
Yeah, thank you, Kevin. Indeed, it is the word of God to us this morning. Well, I'll come back as we conclude our series looking at the church, the last one today. So I want to come back to something which I mentioned a few weeks ago, and to conclude by thinking about the unity of the church, and particularly unity in diversity, or diversity in unity, whichever way you look at it. I want to share with you, to get to the point this morning of sharing, four Bible principles for maintaining unity. It's a precious thing to Jesus, and I want to talk to you through four things that the Bible says to us that we need to have in mind, four things we need to do in order to maintain unity. And I think this is a really important subject for us right now, because I love some good news. What we're going to talk about this morning applies not only for church, but for all aspects of life. And I'm very aware that there's a lot of people under a lot of pressure. Now, I'll start off by revealing a little something that you wouldn't know about me yet. Peter has alluded to it once, but I'm a bit of a pyromaniac. I am fascinated with fire. I like fire. Andrew will tell you that I'm very precious about the fire. Fire in the log burner here. I'm always fiddling. She said, I've just made that up. What are you fiddling with it? I love fire. I bear on my right hand the marks of that. Something that happened when I was 13 years old. It had to do with petrol and a match. We won't say anything more than that. I remember when I was a little bit later, when I really should have known better, late teens, I was with a friend and we decided to experiment and to see what would happen. I'm going to put a disclaimer on this one. Children, do not ever, ever, ever even think about doing this. But we thought we'd experiment in putting a banger in a milk bottle to see what would happen. So we lit the banger, dropped it into the milk bottle and ran and dived headfirst into a ditch about 10 yards away. The banger went off and we went back to see what was left of the milk bottle. And let's just say there was nothing left. It was the most ridiculous thing to do. Had we not got into it, I dread to think about it. Both situations, I think I could very, very easily have killed myself when I nearly set fire to the house with the petrol, which I still bear the marks on my hand, and the stupid thing with the fireworks. Now, I learned this week something fascinating, that to cause an explosion, you need three things. You need to have fuel, you need to have a spark, but the third thing to cause an explosion is you need to have containment. So if I had a can of petrol, I could pour it around and it would, and if I poured it around in a big area, it would set light quite quickly, but it probably wouldn't explode as such. But if I put petrol into an engine, put it into a piston and get the engine moving and inject the petrol in, it will cause an explosion. And that's what makes a petrol engine go round. So you need to have containment. And I think that's why, when I think about society and culture, what we're going through today, why a lot of people are really beginning to struggle. I know we're near the end of lockdown. We can see just a few more weeks, a couple of months, and we'll start to get some relief. But these last few weeks and months have been hard. We've been contained in our homes. We've had people working from home, children schooling from home, mothers doing everything in the home, hardly getting out. And it is not surprising then that in that context, there's been a lot of explosions in home. And you know, we don't like exploding in home. We don't like exploding in church, but it happens. So how can we, and you know, when there's explosions, there's devastation. When things happen, you know, and tempers explode and that kind of thing, it just brings pain and then it has to be put back together. So how can we stop that? How can we mitigate that at home? How do we mitigate it at church? Because we know from what we saw in John chapter 17 that Jesus' big desire was that his people would be united, that we as his people would be united. He prayed to his Father the night before he was arrested. His last prayer before he was taken and arrested was filled with allusions and very specific requests for that his people would be one. He prayed to them in John chapter 7, prayed to Father in John chapter 17, Father, I pray, I plead with you that my people would be one as we are one. And then the various pictures that we've seen over the last few weeks of the church, the bride, the building, the temple, the army and the body, they've all got this idea of unity. Kevin read the passage from Corinthians just there, because Paul was speaking under the inspiration of the Holy Spirit about the unity, the fact that there is diversity, we're all different, and God has made us different and he's given us different gifts, but we are one body. We are to be united. He's deadly serious about this. Corinth was a very diverse church, but it was not united, sadly. It had some wonderful things going on, but it was not united. And that was what Paul was addressing in this section. And that's always the challenge for us in any context, to hold diversity and unity together so that you don't get an explosion. Some people don't try and they'll say, well, it's my way or the highway. If you want to be part of this, then you do it our way. It's easy. Set a list of rules. If people don't reach up to the standard, then you kick them out. Well, you can have a sense of unity like that, but it's not the unity that God wants. It's not how it is in the church. As I say, God is the one that made us different. He's made us different and he's brought us together from different backgrounds. And, we're from different places in our families, different characters, different personalities, different abilities, different likes, different fears. And then God has given us different gifts that we bring to it. We've got different interests. So you'll find in a church, any church, you'll get some that are dead keen. And the most important thing is the teaching of the word. For other people, it will be the sharing of the gospel. For others, it will be caring for people. And the truth is, they're all important. And others will say, no, but it's prayer. We've got to pray. And prayer is equally important. But my experience is that those different personalities, those different interests and the different gifts can sometimes bring conflict of interests within a church. So how do we hold those things together? Because they're all important. How do we fit together without blowing apart? Ephesians chapter 4, verse 3 says this. It says, make every effort. Make every effort to keep the unity of the Spirit. You see, it's not about creating unity. It's about keeping it. We are one in Christ. We're in his family. We're all equal. There's no difference as far as God is concerned. He said, you've got to make every effort. It's not a casual thing. It won't just happen. Got to be intentional about this. So this morning, what are these four principles for keeping or maintaining unity and harmony within the church, within our families, at work, with our neighbors, and those things? Okay, here's number one. Number one Bible principle is this, is that we reserve judgment until I know all the facts. Reserve judgment until I know all of the facts. Proverbs chapter 3, verse 21. It says, my son, do not let wisdom and understanding out of your sight. Preserve sound judgment and discretion. Or as the NLT puts it, and this is going to come on your screen, my child, don't lose sight of common sense and discernment. Hang on to them. Look at that again. Really important. Don't lose sight of common sense and discernment. Hang on to them. Keep hold of them. Discernment is about checking out the facts. Be wise about it. We live in a culture and a society where pretty much anything goes. A phrase that Donald Trump, and I'm not even going to go to say something else. One of the things that Donald Trump left us with is the phrase fake news. I don't think any of us had heard about fake news until Donald Trump came on the scene. But, you know, he actually revealed something that has become a major issue in our world now. Fake news, people putting falsehoods up onto social media with no basis of fact. The campaigns and those ridiculous things that have been said about vaccinations and the idle gossip about them are totally unhelpful. But people believe it because it goes on social media. We have our newspapers, some of us, not many these days, or we'll listen to our news outlets. But you know, those newspapers, those news outlets, they're not neutral. They usually come with a bias of one way or another, depending on which political or social preference the owner has. You all know that some are more left-wing, some are more right-wing, some are more conservative, some are more liberal. Whether it's visual media or paper print media or what you get through your tablet, it's very difficult to discern what is right and what is wrong, what is fact and what is opinion. My child, says the scriptures, do not lose sight of common sense and discernment. We have a responsibility before God, and he calls us to use discernment, wisdom, checking out the facts. The truth is that sometimes we can be so gullible these days that we listen and we believe whatever we hear. Check out the facts. Don't let common sense out of your sight, he says. Preserve it, hold on to it. It won't just happen. Look after it. And that will be the first thing that will help us to maintain peace. Not just assuming what we hear to be right. So very often it's so easy for us to hear something and to repeat it, and it's not right, and it causes hurt, it causes offense, it causes division, it causes suspicion. Proverbs chapter 18, verse 13 says, spouting off before listening to the facts is both shameful and foolish. And 1 Corinthians chapter 4, verse 5 says, don't make judgments about anyone ahead of time. It's a different context, but the truth that he's saying there remains true for all contexts. Don't make judgments about anyone ahead of time. Don't just assume that you know what's going on or why. Check it out. The message is clear. Don't make snap judgments. It works in home. It will always work in church. Let's be careful that we don't assume that we know the person's motives or the whole story. Be careful that you before you believe guilt on someone, or you believe what's said either on social media or through mouth to mouth, over the phone or whatever. Common sense and discernment means that we will check things out first of all. So that's the first thing, reserve judgment until we know all the facts. The second principle from the Bible for maintaining unity is this: be sensitive and empathetic to what offends others. Be sensitive and empathetic to what offends others. In 1 Corinthians chapter 10, 32, verses coming up on your screen. Do not cause anyone to stumble, whether Jews or Greeks, non-Christians, or the Church of God. Okay, is that verse coming up, Martin? Do we have that one or not? Might not have put it in. Let me read it again. Here we go. Do not cause anyone to stumble. That literally means don't cause anyone to be offended. That's what the Greek word there means. Whether they are Jews, Greeks, or the Church of God. That is a crucial verse, because the Jews and the Greeks, they would not be Christians. So don't offend non-Christians or Christians. So it applies to anybody. We've got a responsibility, says God, to be sensitive to what is going to wind people up, and avoid anything that we know that will. Don't cause anyone to stumble. It's not enough for us to say, well, that's their to do. If they get upset about it, you know, that's their fault. They need to whatever. The truth is, I don't get to decide what offends other people, just as other people don't get to decide what offends me. Because very often there's reasons why people are sensitive to one thing or another. It could be things that have happened in their background. It could be things that happened way back in childhood. Experiences they've been through. Things they've seen. Could just be a nervous disposition. We need to be careful that we don't assume because, well, this is the way I am, that everybody else is like him. We need to be sensitive. And God's word says to us, don't cause anyone to stumble. Romans chapter 15. Let me read this to you. This is really important. Romans chapter 15, verses 1 to 3 says, I'm going to read it first in the NIV, then I want to read it in the NLT because this is an important passage. We who are strong ought to bear with the failings of the weak and not to please ourselves. Each of us should please our neighbors for their good, to build them up. For even Christ did not please himself, but as it is written, the insults of those who insult you have fallen on me. Let me read that again in the New Living Translation. You who are strong must be considerate to those who are sensitive about things like this. We must not please ourselves. We should help others do what is right and build them up in the Lord, for even Jesus didn't live to please himself. So the point is this: to maintain unity, to de-escalate explosions and conflicts, we need to think before we speak. We need to be sensitive. How will this person receive this? It says in Ephesians about speaking the truth in love. We need to think, what's the nicest way? What's the kindest way I can say this? Is this going to help this person or not? Mustn't assume that just because it doesn't offend me, it won't offend them, or I can say it in a particular way. You've got to be careful about other people. Don't cause anyone to stumble. But the trouble is we do, don't we? We've all done it. So I just want for a moment, what do we do when we fall into the mistake of causing someone to stumble, causing offense to someone, winding someone up, because we're not perfect and we do it. What do we do when that's happened? How do we get back to the unity? How do we stop the schism, the split, the hurt developing? Well, we talked about being under pressure, didn't we? And when there's pressure, there's an explosion. And often use this illustration with children, but I think it works for all of us. Toothpaste. And if you squeeze the tube of toothpaste, what comes out? Of course, toothpaste comes out. But what if it was something in the toothpaste tube that wasn't toothpaste? You'd squeeze it and that would come out. The point is that the toothpaste is fine. Like this, no problem at all. Andrea's not too fussed whether I've got this tube of toothpaste in her lounge and on the floor. But if I open it up and now I start, actually, I'm not going to do it. Don't worry, darling. If I then squeezed it, what is inside will come out. When we're under pressure in our life, when we're feeling confined, when we're feeling threatened and squeezed, what is inside will naturally come out. And what's inside is not always very good. We're not yet perfect. We're in progress. And most of the time we can contain it, can't we? We keep it down and we don't let out what's inside. But sometimes when we get squeezed, when we get wound up, when we get cross, when we get angry, we feel I've been squeezed too much, and then what's inside will come out. Jesus said, it's not what goes into you that makes you defiled, it's what comes out of you. You want to know what we're really like? What are we like under pressure? Let's not make it hard for each other. Let's not put them under pressure. What do we do? Well, there's a verse in Matthew chapter 5, verse 25. It says this. It says, settle matters quickly with those that you're at odds with. Settle matters quickly. In other words, what Jesus is saying, the words of Jesus, he's saying, go and sort it out. Take the initiative to sort the problem out. Don't wait for them simply to come to you. It's never enough for us to say, well, it's their fault. They shouldn't be quite so sensitive. They need to get over it. It doesn't wash for us as Christians. Jesus says, It doesn't matter whether we intended to take offense or not. If they have and we've hurt someone, if we've done something that puts the unity at danger, then it's our responsibility to go and sort it out. If I think then I've hurt someone, if I think I've offended, then I need to go and say sorry. Take the initiative. That's the first thing. That applies whether it's in home or, you know, in church or at work. I can't believe that Andrew and I are the only ones that ever kind of misunderstand each other, that sometimes we don't wind each other up. We do. Don't be too shocked that your pastor and his wife have times when they wind each other up. Key thing is being humble enough, and I'm going to come to that in a moment. But the key thing is that one of you needs to go and say, look, what's going on? We're sorry. Let's sort this out. And that will work in every situation. Point is, don't leave it to everybody else. Get on and do it. Jesus says, settle matters quickly. And that's the second thing. Do it quickly. So we take the initiative, but he says, do it quickly as you can. An unattended wound. I had my gardening gloves out just now. I put them on because I don't want to get pricked and poked when I'm gardening. But if I get a thorn in my finger, if I leave it, it's more likely to go bad. So try and get the thorn out. If you've got a wound, you leave it, it will fester. It will go bad. Sort it out, and sort it out quickly, says Jesus. And then Romans chapter 12 gives us the third help under this little section here. Romans 12, 18 says, if it is possible, as much as depends on you, live at peace with everyone. So he's saying, do it sensitively. That's the effect of what he's saying. Do it sensitively. As much as lies within you, as much as you can, be sensitive to the other person and live at peace. If I've wound somebody up, it's no good me going to them and being cross with them. If I could just go back to the analogy with me and Andrew, if I've wound Andrea up and she's grumpy with me and I've given a good reason, it's no good me going in and kind of being cross with her because she's cross with me. I need to go sensitively. As much as is possible, as much as I can, I need to do my bit towards this. So I need to be sensitive to the other person. Do those three things. Take the initiative, do it quickly, and be sensitive. And it will help us in these kind of things. So that's the second Bible principle. Be sensitive and empathetic to the other person. The third one is this. I need to limit my freedom out of love. We're going to move on quickly in these last two sections. They're not as long as the first two. I need to limit my freedom out of love. Now, giving you a reference there, Galatians chapter 5 and 13 through to 15. Here's what it says. But don't use your freedom to satisfy your sinful nature. Instead, use your freedom to serve one another. The verse goes on. For the whole law can be summed up in this one command, love your neighbor as yourself. But if you're always biting and devouring one another, watch out. Beware of destroying one another. Wow, that's tough, isn't it? He's talking to Christians. He's talking to the church of Christ. He said, don't use your freedom to satisfy just because you've been set free by Christ. Don't do whatever you want. Instead, use your freedom to serve one another. He talks about devouring one another, biting one another. Watch out. Warning here about destroying one another. Oh, wouldn't it be terrible if we destroyed someone? Love one another. Love your neighbor as yourself. And in Romans chapter 14, really, really valuable words. So then, let us aim. Let us aim. Let's target. Let's desire. Let's seek for. Let's work for harmony in the church and try to build each other up. There's a bit in the middle. Don't tear apart the work of God over what you eat. Remember, all foods are acceptable. It's wrong to eat something if it makes another person stumble. And then he comes back to this section. It is better not to eat meat or drink wine or do anything else if it might cause another believer to stumble. Aim for harmony. Build each other up. It's better not to do it, not to do something, if it might cause another person to stumble. The context, the church at Rome, was this thing that we talked about in Corinth, It was a big problem for the early church. It was the thing of whether you could eat food that had been taken to a pagan temple, hadn't been used, but it had been part of a sacrifice. And then it would, the common thing was to put it on the open market and people could buy it. Could a Christian eat food that had been part of or associated with a pagan sacrifice? Paul's point was, yes, it can. The pagan God is not a real God. It's a makeup thing. It really doesn't make any difference. But he said, look, there are people that get really offended by that. There are some people that don't see it like that. And so for their sake, don't use your freedom to hurt them. Don't cause them to stumble. If it's going to cause somebody to stumble, it's better not to eat that meat. Limit your freedom because of your love for your brother or sister. And he was very clear. They were in the wrong. They didn't need to be as sensitive, he said, but they are. And so for their sake, limit what you do. And so for us, we need to be careful that we don't just think, well, it's my right to do this. Just be sensitive. And out of love, sometimes we need to rein back what we might do because of people's tender consciences. Just because something is okay and fine before God doesn't mean that it's going to be okay for me to do it if it's going to hurt someone else. It's the basic principle, the basic Christian principle, the golden rule. But you ask people, what's the golden rule? Think of others before yourself. Any people in the world will say that, won't they? Your friends, your colleagues, people at school, people at work. Think of others. Treat others as you'd like them to treat you. Golden rule. That's actually biblical. Comes from the Bible. Don't be concerned for your own good, but for the good of others. He says in 1 Corinthians chapter 10, in the same chapter, he says, if I try to please everyone in everything I do, I don't just do what's best for me, I do what's best for others that they may be saved. I find that an interesting one. Because one of those verses is about the good of others. It's about our family. It's about our church family. It's thinking, what's going to be good for the church? The second verse in there is about doing good for the unbeliever. You know, how's my words, how's my action, what I do, how's that going to affect other people? He says, so that they may be saved. So there's a context here, and there's a teaching here that the way we do things, just because we can do it, doesn't make it right. Is it going to hinder them? Is it going to stop them hearing the gospel when I want to talk to them about Jesus? If it does, he says, I'm not going to do that thing, because the most important thing is not getting my way. It's not exercising my freedom. It's thinking, will they be saved? It's their soul. It's a question of will they get into heaven or not. So sometimes we need to limit our freedom simply out of love for other people. And then very briefly, the last point, the last fourth biblical principle for maintaining unity is very simply, always be kind and humble. Just about our attitude. Giving you two references here. We'll read them. They're going to come up on the screen. Philippians chapter 2 and Proverbs chapter 3. So Philippians chapter 2, don't be selfish. This is God's word to us. Don't be selfish. Don't try to impress others. Be humble. Thinking of others as better than yourselves. And in that passage, it then goes on to talk about Jesus, who, though he was God, did not consider equality with God something to be grasped, but gave himself up and humbled himself even to the point of the cross. He said, look, be humble, be gentle with other people, be like Jesus. And then the verse in Proverbs chapter 3, let love and faithfulness never leave you. Bind them round your neck, write them on the tablet of your heart. I like the way the New Living Translation has this one. It says, let loyalty and kindness. You know, we can never be loving, we can never be loyal without being humble. He says, wear them like a necklace. Humility, kindness, love, thoughtfulness. Put them on, keep them on. Take them with you wherever you go. So they're always with you, they're always part of it. As it said at the beginning, the vast passage that we started with right at the beginning, never let them out of your sight. Never let them go every day. What changes when we're humble? When we're humble, it'll affect the way we talk, won't it? The way we speak to other people, the way we treat them, the words we use and the way we say them. Most arguments are caused by words themselves or by the tone of our voice. We can say something, but the tone of our voice, if it doesn't match the words, there's a difference between saying, oh, I love you, and darling, I don't half love you, or whatever you might say to your spouse. You get the point, don't you? It's the tone of voice. It's about humility. It's about gentleness. Finally, one of my favourite verses, I try and have this as a watchword. I don't always get it right, and I fall short way too often. But a verse that has meant a lot to me, and has been, I try and have it as a watchword for me, Ephesians chapter 4, 29. And maybe it's special because I need it so much, but it says this: let everything that you say be good and helpful. Let everything you say be good and helpful, so that your words will be an encouragement to those who hear them. Four principles from the Bible about maintaining the harmony and the unity. Reserve judgment until I know all the facts, Proverbs 3:21. Be sensitive and empathetic to what offends others, 1 Corinthians chapter 10, 32. Limit my freedom out of love, Galatians chapter 5, and always be humble and kind, both Philippians 2 and Proverbs chapter 3. May God help us. May he bless us, his church, and may he help us to be the people that he's called to be. May we glorify him in all that we do. May we glorify him in our ministry, in our lives. May he be the focal point. When people talk about Fressingfield Baptist Church, may their minds go to God. When they look at our building, may their thoughts go to God. When they come in among us, may their thoughts go to God and how good and how great and how kind and how loving he is. And key to that will be the way that we treat each other, the way we value each other, the way we talk to each other, how sensitive and tender we are with each other. May we live to glorify God, and may he be pleased to pour out his Holy Spirit upon us for his good, his glory, and our good. God bless you. I trust that this little series has been helpful for us. If you've got any questions, we will do another Q&A at some point. Thank you for those of you who got in touch this week to say how much you enjoyed the Q&A last Sunday evening. I've got to say, I enjoyed it too. We'll do it again. And maybe some of the things which we've looked at over these 8 weeks of looking at the church have raised some questions, or you'd like some clarification, or you think they're worth digging into some more. And I definitely think that's the case, because a couple of occasions people say, oh, there was a lot in there this morning. And I had 4 points this morning in 20 minutes. That's a lot to get through, a lot that could be unpacked there. But hope they've been helpful. Let us know if you've got any questions, clarifications, or you want anything added to it, gladly do that. Let's finish with a song just focusing on Jesus. It's all about him, and you know, without him, we're weak, but he is strong. It's that lovely song, "Yet Not I, But Through Christ in Me."
What gift of grace is Jesus my Redeemer? My joy, my righteousness and freedom, my steadfast love, my deep and boundless peace. To this I hold, my hope is only Jesus, for my life is wholly bound to his. Oh, how strange and divine, I can see. All is mine, yet not I, but through Christ in me. through Christ in me.
Father, we want to be your servants. We know we can only be good servants when it's Christ living through us by the Holy Spirit. Thank you for all that you've done in us so far, and we're trusting you and we're looking forward to what you're going to do in the future. We want you to keep changing us, keep renewing us. Help us to be the people that you would want us to be, so that we as a group of people might be a city on a hill. A bright shining light that draws people to you. We thank you for your love. We thank you for each other. May we treasure each other, and may we hold these principles close to our heart that you've been teaching us this morning, that we might walk forward increasing and in love and unity and harmony for your good. God, we love you. We thank you that you've brought us together. We thank you for our family here. And we give ourselves for you to take and to use for your glory and your praise. Now may the grace of the Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God our Father, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with each one of you today and always. Amen. Amen. And may God bless you all. Thank you for joining us today. It's lovely to see you.